Harper Audio presents The Dying of the Light, a novel by Robert Goolrick, performed by Kirby Heyborne. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. Psalm 46, verses 4 through 6. Prologue. It begins with a house, and it ends in ashes. There's your opening, you think. You can wrap it up and go home now. Phone it in, and you haven't even set foot on the property. But it's true. That is the complete family history. Except, between the building in 1748 and the burning, somebody, or a number of people who weren't supposed to die, died in this house in a disastrous fire on December 5th, 1941. This is all you know, all anybody knows, all there is to be known. The rest is detailed, just local color. Of course, that's why they sent you, to sift through the ashes, to somehow find a bone in the ash, a bone that would unravel a mystery that has stood silent and unbreakable for almost 60 years. You are standing at dawn on the prow of an oyster boat you've hired for the day, moving, trailing a wide wake in a calm black river under a sky the color of unpolished silver to get there. The only boat on the lazy river, the fish running somewhere else. Finally to reach the house, the remains of history, the remnants of her life. You are trespassing, even now. The house, barely glimpsed from the prow of the oyster boat where you stand, making its slow way down from Port Royal, the house, even in silhouette, is huge, unimaginably large, four square. Saratoga, the name coming from the old Indian language, means the hillsides of the quiet river, the hunting grounds by the water. It's not as though you haven't done your homework. The house had been modeled after the gigantic house of the Earl of Shaftesbury, St. Giles' house, and though slightly smaller, it was still the biggest house in America, with uncountable rooms and a grandiosity that quickened the heart of all who saw it. The cost was enormous, the first and greatest of many folies de grandeur that left the owners in a state of bondage and near poverty, only redeemed by the labors of, at the most, 900 slaves who picked the cotton and cured the tobacco and boiled the peanuts and, for generations, cleaned up their messes in a silent, sly rage. Robbed of their humanity, these 900 looked at the house from the start and envisioned it in flames, hearing in their wistful hearts the terrible screams of their oh-so-white masters. Not able to flee, sold like dogs in the street, robbed of their children, babies ripped from their mother's arms in Natchez or Memphis. It was a house built on tears. Did four die? Three, or just one? Diana Cook Copperton Cook. Was it accidental or arson, as the inept sheriff's office proclaimed? Whoever was there, the fire burned flesh to bone and bone to ash, and the ash blew into oblivion. If she had somehow lived, she would be 99 years old now. Unlikely, but not impossible. And, in the unlikely event that she was alive, where would she be? She was declared dead after 7 years in 1948, and the son took control of what was left of her money, not much, which he used occasionally. But where did the rest go? There was supposed to be a fortune. Fortunes like that don't just disappear, and she couldn't have spent it all. So perhaps there was no arsonist except herself. But inside the doll of her life, there was another, and another, and another, and another, smaller and smaller, all fitting together, and somewhere in the tiniest box was her soul and her affections. There was her son, Ashton, far away, never forgotten for one minute, the only thing that made her heart continue beating. Mostly she dreamed of Ashton, her only boy, his handsome face and infinite charm. Because he had spent so much of his life apart from her, his face appeared as a slideshow, not a movie. Ash, at 8, getting on the train, weeping at the window of his compartment, and then after that, jumping from vacation to vacation, his growth a shock every time, pretending at affection during these short visits, when in reality she knew less and less about him. Even the bills for his clothes went to his trustees, so that when he arrived in a new coat, it was always a shock. You are speculating from what you know. You are seeing it for the first time, and yet it is not new to you. Hours spent poring over books and articles and stacks of photographs have led you to expect exactly what you are now seeing, and you are both satisfied and disappointed that there is nothing more than this, making you wonder why you have come all this way, and yet it is new. It is somehow unexpected, perhaps simply by virtue of the fact that you are here, and it is larger, wider than you had thought, the wind more brisk, saltier, everything surprising. The way it feels when you first see Niagara Falls, expecting only tourists and disappointment, and finding wonder. Wonder at the power and the size of it, a child's delight. And here, as there, everything else washes away. The crew of the boat, the flights of gulls, the expectation of thunder, lost in the mystery of the attainment of this one small goal. And the mystery, the thing that made you get out the magnifying glass and study the pictures under a light, all that wakes up in your heart. And your heart beats in your jaded throat just for a minute, until you remember that it is only this, only a job that will get done as they always do, done and left behind, measured by the number of internet hits, the number of shares. You have nothing new to add. That much seems certain. You had felt you knew her as much as could be known. Now you see you know nothing. There it is, a silhouette in the distance at the end of what was once a long yard edged by gardens. Some say she still lives there, ancient, in the gatehouse, but there is no movement. No sign except the white tail of a deer flashing as it breaks into the bracken, nothing but the ruin of the house that was built 3 centuries ago and was called and still is, even in its ruination, Saratoga. You have come a long way for this, and you have come by water because that's how they came, the first ones, and because the mile-long drive to the road that leads to Port Royal, the nearest town, is so overgrown as to be impassable. The blackened house, almost unrecognizable as brick, sits in what was once a grant of 50,000 acres from George I to one John Cook. King Cook, they called him. Call him still, around here, the first of three. The first men who came with him had come here, come to nothing, and cleared the land with mules and blacks and sweat, and lived in lean-tos in the winter months, barely surviving, Americans before there was an America, strong backs and legs, and they fought the red men who owned the land since time began, and they cleared the trees with mules and sweat and opened 1 acre after another until they could build the first house and farm the first fields and send for the women from whom all the rest of them descended. Blood was everything to them, cousin and kin, a line of cooks who went on to found the great capitals and named the nation they had ripped from the land and its native owners. They signed documents, and their signatures are under glass in museums. They made speeches, and some of their words ring in the mouths of patriots even today, often misunderstood, misused, vicious, and vindictive, when it had all begun in such hope, such stitching, and then waving of flags and banners. There are no banners now, not here. There is no sound except the wind and the water lapping at the boat. No sound, no human cry, no laughter or weeping or speech, just this. This monument to a family's life of work and folly, to their joys and struggles inside the four walls when the house was still standing, endlessly gossiped about in the town before the awful fire, the fire that melted the silver on the sideboard, that turned the mahogany and damask to ash. The pickers came after. Nobody stopped them once the embers were cool enough to walk across with stiff boots, and still it was hot, almost too hot to bear, burned the soles of your feet all to hell. And the rest they took, the ivory from the piano keys, the shreds of oriental rugs, and here and there a sterling candlestick, a punch ladle, a baby cup with initials, a Canton platter. Landscape diminishes as we approach. First, the vast line of green, indistinguishable, seen from out at sea, then the particularities of coast and tide, and the trees themselves, pines and magnolia and dogwood, the elms and maples fallen into the dull sand, giants toppled by time and neglect, and then what would have been the lawn, the long flat up to the house where she may or may not still live, for there is no way to know. If she lived, no one would see her. If she died, no one to mourn, unless they, the two servants left to her at the end, now long dead, had not moved on, but had found a way to cling to the land, to wrest copper pots and vessels from the ash, for carrying water and for cooking. Had she lived, she would be 99, and the servants, all of her contemporaries, would be long dead. And you, here, now, 1999, before the century's turning, with your lined notebook and your Nikon, in your topsiders, new, what were you thinking, knowing more about this house and about her than almost anybody, but still not knowing the thing, the core of the mystery? You've seen the house, ghost-like, in the museum in town. There is a plan, a group of men and women who are raising millions, although they are millions away from what they need to do, what they want to do, which is to build around the ruins of the house a glass model of Saratoga as it was, every staircase, every fireplace, and a cruel, magnificent thing it would be, this jewel box, if they were to get their millions, but they never will. Not enough people care enough to get them what they need to build their glass dollhouse of one of the most important Georgian houses ever built in this country. Nobody cares about history now. Nobody gives a shit. On the table in the museum, there are even tiny people, in their frock coats and sweeping silk dresses, strolling the lawn, dancing a minuet in the first ballroom in any house in America, 30 by 50 feet, given over to graceful pleasures and nothing else, giving a synecdochic idea of the vastness of the rest of it all, if that much space could be devoted simply to the pleasures of the dance. There was a huge columned downstairs hallway watched over by a butler with a double staircase that led up to a gallery and the sleeping quarters. Upstairs, there were 12 bedrooms. Downstairs, an orangery facing west, with oranges and lemons and limes in profusion, even in the winter. There was a dining room that could seat 40. A sitting room.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.